Hi, good morning all. So for next couple of minutes, we will be talking about markets, investing more, not about the industry, but more about the market, right? Agreed? All of you ready for that? Okay, so tea was good. Fine, so basically when I'm saying learning from the last market cycle, look at the last 6 years market. 13 and 17, we had a rewarding phase into equity particularly. And 17-19 a testing phase. So kind of a full cycle we have seen in the last 6 years as far as the equity investing goes. And every cycle teaches you something. Now when I'm talking about the lessons, it's not about the newness of lesson, but basically about what kind of a extension in our investing tool we need to get into investment science, right? So that's the focus. I'll give three different lessons which is important right now. Then I'll talk about two risk measuring tools and one observation of the market. So start with this straight away. You know, most of you who are into the side of the managing money, you know that managing a small cap company is a little different and managing a large cap company portfolio is a little different. Basic remains same, but the kind of tool you require for managing a small cap portfolio or a large cap portfolio are a little different. Look at where the country is. So I'm trying to get through the context in which these changes are has to be incorporated. Now India, our aspiration could be much, much higher, but already today, we are one of the large economy in the world. So gone are the days of 100 billion, 400 billion in 2000-2002, when India was a small cap stock in the global economic perspective. Today, in the PPP term, we are already third largest economy in the world. In nominal GDP also, we are the sixth largest. Now this change of economy from a small cap kind of economy to a large cap kind of economy requires even those who are on the side of money to fine tune some of the investing tools, right? Also, we all are aware that huge amount of changes are happening in the way business happens in India. The whole method of running a business is changing in India per se. Even our own industry, the investing industry, so much changes have happened in terms of product, the customer reach, etc. Information has become a commodity. Information transmission is almost on a click. In that scenario, and also if you look at the institutional part, participation in the market has gone tremendously high in the last 20 years. Now these changes surely necessitates some kind of a change in the investment strategy of ours. Look at the chart. Remember 20 years back, our own Sensex used to be, you know, 3,000 levels, and year and a half, 2 years, it used to go to 6,000 levels. So every 2 years, our market used to double, and our market used to come by half. We all know the earning doesn't change that rapidly. What does that imply? That implies that the price earning multiple of the valuation is to go double in 2 years or 1.5 years, and is to come down by half. So that kind of a changes in a valuation multiple. So even if you do a little bit of good fundamental research and you wait for 8-9 months, though the stocks used to come to a price where you had a huge amount of margin of safety in those periods. After you bought the stock, even if a mediocre performance happens fundamentally for the company, the stock price return used to be phenomenal. So between 1990 and 2000, you got 6 opportunities of a very low PE to buy to the market. Between 2000 and 2010, you got 5 opportunities. Since 2000, you have got only, in fact, none opportunity at a very low valuation multiple. A recent RBI paper also states that the market cycle has become long, you know, the market cycle duration has become expanded a lot, and the curvature of the cycle has become very flat. And that curvature is asking us to make some adjustment in our investment methods. So, you know, typically between the price and the value, the dislocations are very large. Then identifying a stock and participating into that stock is much, much easier. But in this regime, where the curvature of cycle is very flat and you don't have too many dislocation on the price value map. Now, unless you do a very hyper bullish estimate for a company or you look too far in the time span, then you might still identify some dislocation. But ideally, there are not much of a dislocation possible today in our market in terms of price value difference. Now, what does that mean? That we have to now employ as a fund manager the subtler nuances of portfolio management. So one part surely is a stock picking, But now those subtler nuances of portfolio managing, like how much to allocate on a stock and how to play a combination. So when you buy multiple stocks in a portfolio, their combination makes the risk return characteristic of the overall portfolio completely go divergent. So the first lesson is now the subtler nuances like allocation and combinations are equally important than the just stock picking, which was an easier job for me to do 10 years back, 15 years back. The other part, other lesson to explain, I'll just break through a typical equity research, what you do. So in a process, and by definition, process is something which can be cut down into sub-processes. So typically equity research, what you do five of these sub-processes inside an equity research. So you make, you learn about the business, economic environment in which the business is working, or you call that macro or economic cycle or something, you can name it in any way. Then the other part of the process is the management. What is their vision? What is their target? Do they have execution capability to deliver and achieve the target? In terms of financing strategy, raising funds, deploying funds, in terms of marketing strategy, the product positioning, the pricing, the supply chain management, brands. Then you look for all the moat in the business. So all the drivers, revenue driver, cost driver, cash flow drivers, to identify whether there's a sustainable moat or not. Then you do headline financials, quarterly numbers, annual reports, and the valuation. So these are the five different sub-processes we typically run when we do equity research. Now, there are two typical style of doing it. Like, some of us like to start with a macro thesis first. So we build a macro scenario, how the economy will play out in the next 6 months, 1 year. Then we identify the right management in the business through which I can write that micro thesis of my own. So that's a typically called top-down strategy. The reverse is the bottom-up strategy, which goes just other way around, not necessarily in the order in which it is written here, but largely in line with how the two strategy goes. Look at it this way. Last 2 years, I just saw a statistics. Among the stocks listed on NSE, the 70% stock has fallen by more than 30%, kind of a Pareto rule variation. So 70% stocks are down by more than 30%. It's very easy for us to give some kind of excuse that valuation was very high, business management was something fishy. But look at the macro context. Between 2013 and 17 middle, the interest rate cycle has going dying on down and down. So almost 9% we started 2013 third quarter. The interest rate kept falling and falling, went close to 6% in June 2017. We were riding the bull market, right? Then 17 onwards, the rates started going up. At the middle of last year, August 2018, the rate again up more than 8%. These are 10-year bond yields. At the same time, on the right-hand side chart, you can see the liquidity was very surplus. The negative signs are surplus liquidity in the system. Starting February, March 17, the liquidity were very tight, and it so happened in the last quarter of third and fourth quarter of last calendar year, we had a deficit in the liquidity in the system. So just giving alibi for this 70% stock falling by more than 30% on valuation or wrong management, wrong business is not enough. It's a little myopic in that sense. We cannot ignore the macro cycle which played out. See, idea is you cannot, it's not easy to get a perfect business in a portfolio. Every businesses, if you look at, there always will be some moving parts where you are not very sure about. Perfection only happens in a textbook, right? So the macro cycle impact you can see in this last cycle. Now, what does it say? It can be seen also like a what is called bullwhip, right? Bullwhip, one end, if you do little bit of deviation, the other moves very violently, right? Which is what we have seen in the last cycle at a very large scale in our market. What does it tell us? That tells us ki now it's not easy for some just be focusing on one part of the research process, only on the micromanagement or only on the financials, running some screener and doing something on that. We need to be very sure all the legs of this research process. We have to be more comprehensive than what we used to be in the past, because our market was a typical stock. So like 10 years back when you spoke to anyone, India is a very stock picker market. Now no one talks about India is a stock picker, which is very understandable. We are no more a small cap country. We are a little higher mid to cap country. So we need to be very sure there. Another way to look at the same thing, remember when the science of investing started last century, initially it was all about, you should know the headline financial, capital, working capital kitna hai, gross kitna, etc. Make some valuation bet on any parameter, and used money, what was used to be called cigar butt investing, right? Then the paradigm shifted and the whole focus was on the management and the business, the mode of the business management. And that was the route to make a long-term sustainable good amount of wealth from the market, what we call value investing. But now the last piece of the meal you cannot ignore. In an advanced, connected, easily commoditized information economy, you cannot ignore the last piece. So that's the second learning, that you have to be very, very comprehensive in kind of thing you are doing. The third learning in terms of from the cycle is, let's take a typical stock market cycle. I'm not a technical analyst, Atul bhai aa gaye hain yahan pe, but I'm just giving you a background of my own way of how I see through in a fundamental sense. See, naturally you spot a company where the fundamental is improving gradually. So margins is expanding or something, sales is expanding. Pans for 2-3 quarters. So doing research on one company in a fundamental sense requires 2-3 quarters. It's not something you can do an evening study and tomorrow it's about a stock time, right? So if something improves gradually over 2-3 quarters, you do your research, get your conviction right, and you buy the stock. Things the company fundamentally still keeps gradually improving. After a while, it enters a re-rating phase. A lot of people start seeing that stock. Things re-rate, you get your 1x, 2x, 3x kind of a story. And ultimately, it is called a story zone. It becomes popular, people talk about that stock. It's into a story zone. Inside the story zone, you figure out that there is some gradual deterioration in the fundamentals, which requires either the valuation multiple should come down or maybe a blow off should happen. Because that deterioration also happens gradually. It's a company which moves higher gradually, the fundamental improves gradually, fundamental deteriorates also gradually. So you got a time to sell if that happens 2-3 quarters. And after you sell, whatever happened, you are not worried. It's a great scenario. Many of you who are into picking stocks on a fundamental basis will agree. Just think about some of your example in your head. This is how the story goes. What you will say, it's a fairy tale. Or maybe at the best, kabhi kabhi hota hai, right? But look at the other scenario where a fundamental improves very sharply. Look at a lot of stocks which ran 16-17 cycle, where the margin in just 1 quarter doubled. In those kind of where the fundamental improved not in a regular gradual fashion, but in a discrete lumpy fashion, what happened? The deterioration also happened very fast. Smooth 2-3 quarters of studying the company and becoming convinced, and you can buy right in that for that stock if the improvement is very, very sharp. And something which is improving very sharp surely will deteriorate also very, very sharp. You can have n number of examples in your head in the last market cycle. So the idea is, most of us who are on the business where we are not very sure of our market, our timing skill, at least I am not very sure about my timing skill, in that scenario my own safety is buying only those company where the improvement happens slowly and gradually, because then I am sure the deterioration will also happen slowly and gradually, and I'll get a time to exit on time, right? So that's the next, that's the other lesson, the cycle that we just saw in our market. So those were three lessons just narrated. A couple of points for some of the risk, the way risk can be seen even better, you know. So any portfolio you publish, even in PMS Bazaar, what Pallav does, you have some gross statistics. What is the overall PE of the portfolio, right? We just see that number in a table. What is the overall, say, quality parameter, ROE, or could any number for that example? And what is the, so for every stock in the portfolio, what is the weighted average profit growth or sales growth of the portfolio? So as a gross level of your portfolio, the quality of the portfolio, the valuation, and the growth quoted to the portfolio. Just look at a very simple elementary math, the 3D geometry. Now what is to happen, you have X, Y, Z axis, and these three can be easily depicted on that 3D geometry. Why I'm trying to make that visual is, it's a digital era right now. Our mind processes better when we see something digitally. Table mein aata hai, ignore ho jata hai, right? So this is one good way of looking at the portfolio, and you can look the portfolio how it is in that inside the 3D, where your portfolio is right now. You can compare your portfolio with another portfolio, or maybe the benchmark, maybe Nifty or S&P 500. Where the stock of Nifty is positioned right now. Now this difference in the location of your portfolio and the benchmark or a peer portfolio will give you an idea what possibly will portfolio result later on. So this is one way of trying to visualize that. The other thing I would like to talk is like price, you know, which usually ignore, I also do a lot. But we have realized, so there's a very important maxim in the trading community particularly, cut your losses, let the profit run, right? even the fundamental investors at times have said about Peter Lynch in one up on the Wall Street, he has written, selling your winners and holding your losers is like cutting the flowers and watering the weeds. Even Mr. Buffett, in his 1988 shareholding, the letter to shareholders, he has spoken on a very similar line. So price, surely you cannot be, in an era where the price value difference is not very high, you cannot ignore completely the price dynamic, price or return parameter. Now, just to do the risk management on a price basis, we can, deconstruct the, so market prices moves in a random fashion or maybe some fashion. But the idea is we can deconstruct the market movement in a alternative swings. We all intuitively know market moves in swings. So you have a 10-12% rally, then a 7-8% fall, then another 15% rally, and then 10% fall. So market typically moves in alternate swings of up and down, right? So we can deconstruct a market in different up and down swings. And then the easy thing is just look at on any swings. So usually we are very popular with, last 1 year CAGR return kya raha, 5 year CAGR kya raha, but I think that's a medicine expired date cross ho chuka hai. I think we need to be more proactive in that sense. So on those every swings, we can compute what my portfolio excess return is over the benchmark or a peer portfolio. Similarly, we can on every swings, we can compute what is the wall of my portfolio vis-a-vis the benchmark or any other portfolio. Now, these two information, the excess return on each of the swing and excess return on the each of the swings in terms of wall statistics, if you combine the two, you get a, so my own learning here in this chart is like, if I see a portfolio or even my own portfolio underperforming on two consecutive swings, and at the same time, if my wall is say 1.3 times higher than what the benchmark wall is, surely there is some big cockroach inside my portfolio. So it's a very easy tool for investors also, how to take decision on a portfolio, which portfolio to buy. Just deconstruct swing is simple Excel sheet, maybe it's not a very hard job to do, but you can figure out how it is happening. So that's the price side of it. Right, I'll just share I think I got 3 minutes now. So long back, while reading the Howard Marks memo, one of the earliest memo, I think first memo that is on the Oak Tree website, he has written about a fund where he said there is a fund on a yearly basis, this fund was never above the 27th percentile. So never was in a top quartile. But at the same time, the fund was never below 47th percentile. So it was always in the second quartile, 50% to 550% bracket. Every year during the 14-year period, but when you combine the 14-year together, this fund was in the fourth percentile. Now, when I was doing a study this September end about Indian various mutual fund schemes, what I figured out, almost what Howard Mark had said in 1990, clearly what is happening today. So look at the last 5 year funds in India in terms of return from 2014 September to 19 September. If you look at the annual statistics, those funds were, the top 10 funds were never in the top decile particularly. They were all between 20th and 50th percentile. But altogether, if you look at 14 September to 19 September, those are the top 10 mutual fund schemes. That reminds me of what Howard Mark has said in that memo, that really long-term investing success depends upon is striving to do a little better than average every year. Here the focus is on average, better than average every year. So that's the one way of identifying a fund or a portfolio which will do better for you in the next 10, 15 years. This reminds me of the story of that Kachua and Khargosh, which a lot of us has grown with. So once when I had first read memo, that reminded me typically what turtle rabbit story chal rahi thi. And I realized at least in one fashion, market never changes. We have made the extension to the Kachua Khargosh story in a number of ways, depending upon our own way of living life. But at least in investment, long-term success, the Kachua Khargosh story remains same. As Howard Mark said, just striving to do a little better than average every year consistently, ultimately goes to the final better results. So I'll skip through this. So those are the main summary. I just spoke about three key learnings. The one learning was for sure, allocation and combination decisions are of no less important. Usually we are very good in storytelling about a company and stocks. I also get biased and carried away in the direction. But the idea is allocation combination decisions are equally important. Market cycle has become longer and the curvature has become a lot flat. A comprehensive approach, blurring the line between a macro and a bottom-up investing is what the need for the next decade would be. Stock with gradual and prolonged improvement helps deal with the issue of poor market timing of many of us. And knowing the how the market is looking, how the market is, you know, punishing or rewarding your portfolio on a time swing analysis, which I just narrated, is a good idea to be a proactively managing risk. And striving to do a little better than the average every year is better for long-term performance. Thanks for your patient listening. Thank you.